It is 7 o'clock on the 14th of March, and we will call our Town of Frederick meeting to order. Megan, will you take the roll for us, please?
Trustee Lamock?
Here.
Trustee Brown?
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem March?
Here.
Mayor Kreitz?
Here.
Trustee Mahan?
Here.
Trustee Tivaldi?
Here.
Trustee Padilla?
Here.
Glad to have you all tonight. Thank you. Let's stand and join each other in the Pledge of Allegiance, please.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Do we have any changes to our agenda tonight?
Mayor Kreitz, I have one change to your agenda. On your consent agenda, the February 28th minutes had a few clerical errors that Trustee Lamock pointed out. I have changed those, so I would ask you to consider those. It doesn't change the content of the minutes, just a few clerical errors.
So we would consider as is?
Yeah, consider as amended.
Thank you. All right, and no other changes, correct? All right, we'll move right into our special presentations. We have the Carbon Valley Half Marathon Community Funding Request. Monica and Mike, please.
Good evening, Madam Mayor and Board of Trustees. Hope you guys are well today. My name is Mike Sindelar. I am the co-founder and course director for the Carbon Valley Half Marathon. I live at 407 Clover Court in Frederick. This is Monica Vicker. She's our race director. We're here today to talk to you a little bit about our race. How many of you guys know about our race that we have every year? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Anybody run it?
No.
Just cheer you on.
Are we offering free registrations to the Town of Frederick?
Yes, we are. Sponsor us,
yep. So this is our 11th year. We started in 2013. And I'm going to let Monica talk about our cause a little bit. What I wanted to point out from my aspect and what I do for the race, as I designed the course, it's a loop course that starts and ends at the Firestone Sports Complex. But I have to say that the highlight of the route that I created 13 years ago is highlighted by some historic and focal points in Frederick. Number one, Millivack Lake. Amazing park, and I've been to many parks in the area, and that is a tremendous facility, and a lot of our participants just love it. So as we come down through the park and down the bike path into Old Town Frederick, which is historic, that's really cool for our participants, especially the ones that come from out of town. They're, you know, from big towns or whatever. They like the small town feeling. And for me, you know, being here since the year 2000, I've watched everything grow. And as Frederick keeps the area kind of intact with that nostalgic sense, you know, it's really cool to hear our participants, you know, rave about it. It's really a great course, and it is highlighted by a lot of the focal points in Frederick. So I'm going to turn it over to Monica. She has some good news to share with our fundraising efforts and what we're requesting from y'all tonight.
Hello, I'm Monica Vickers. I live at 9100 Foxfire Street. I did speak last year also, and I think what's really exciting this year, though, that I wanted to touch on is that we already have people that have signed up for this event from California, Maine, New York, Fort Collins, Boulder, like all over. So like what's really amazing to me is that our event is getting noticed because of its cause for autism, right? Whether people are coming here to visit their family, or they're coming here because they actually want to run an event for autism. It's really amazing. To date, we've raised $130,000 that we've given to the Colorado Children's Hospital. Our event, we just all do this volunteer. We don't make any money. Everything that our event is goes to autism research. Autism personally affects my family, which it does many families here in the area, in the Tri-Town area as a whole. So this is very near and dear to my heart to continue having it. And Mike is correct. The best part of the race is in Frederick. Last year we had to do a little detour, and that was disappointing to me because I do love saying to the race registration people that you're going to run down every street in our area. Like, it's so cool. They see everything from a sports complex, our grocery stores, to our main road through town. I mean, it's just, it's a really cool route. So I'm really hoping this year it should all be back to normal. I haven't got the approval just yet, so I don't want to say that yet, but it doesn't sound like there's any construction possibly, hopefully. But
everyone just be quiet.
Anyway, so we're here tonight again to ask just for the town of Frederick to support our event again, and I'm asking for the funds of $1,500.
Thank you. Thank you for your service and advocating as well. Appreciate seeing you year after year. Appreciate that. Any questions for Monica or Mike tonight?
Why'd you ask for us to be a champion supporter?
Why?
Why? Yeah.
Because that's the $1,500 actually puts you in that spot for that. So that's where that is. It puts you in that, and then you get race registrations. We've provided the sponsorship and asked what you guys wanted to be. It really was never looked at. So when you guys gave us the money of $1,500, we just put it in that slot. Yeah. We do have this top spot that we would love to have Frederick take on. Ward Electric has done it for every year we've been doing that, but
just looking at those, who was the supporters and who does Mead support the no
we get the schools involved, but as far as like the towns, we've only done Firestone and Frederick since we utilize your guys' streets.
Some direction at this time. If there's no other questions, I'd appreciate it. Please.
Madam Mayor, I'd like to request an approval for the funds for the Children's Hospital Autism Research in the Carbon Valley Half Marathon of $1,800.
Motion.
Second.
Yeah. Trustee Mahan?
Yes.
Trustee Padilla?
Yes.
Trustee Lamont?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem March?
Yes.
Trustee Tivaldi?
Yes.
Trustee Brown?
Yes.
Motion passes 6-0.
Thank you very
thank
much.
You. Thank you.
It. Especially the additional funds.
Yes, thank
really
you very
touches
much.
My heart.
Yeah. Appreciate you all.
Thank you.
Good luck with your event. All right, there are no other special presentations, so we'll move into our public comment. This portion of the agenda is provided to allow members of the audience to provide comments to the town board. Please sign in and I will call you if your comments or concerns require an action. Thank you. That item or items will need to be placed on a later agenda, please. And please limit the time of your comments to 3 minutes. I have Gil and Cheryl Garcia, please.
Hi. He's Gil. I'm Cheryl. We live in Eagle Valley for the past 9 years. And as per ADA, I get time and a half. She says, so buckle up. She did provide some written thoughts here so that we don't take too much of your time. Actually, 4 things she wants to talk about, and it's about adding a dog park in the green space between Eagle Valley and Raspberry. She says, our house in Eagle Valley backs to the green space between the Eagle Valley and Raspberry communities. We have a lot of dogs between both neighborhoods. They all walk past our backyard. Everyone knows our dogs, Mr. Snot and Belle. With Firestone closing two of the of their dog parks, I feel it would be beneficial to our neighborhood to have one between the two neighborhoods where they can both take advantage of that, and of course anybody else who wants to use it. Two, an option on snow plowing, shoveling for seniors. Snow shoveling, I would like to suggest asking Public Works to plow the sidewalks for seniors on a fee basis, perhaps $20 per season as a suggestion. No fee for those who can't pay. I can attest to that. The very first snow we had, we just had a little dusting and it hurt my back for about 2 weeks. So, you know, it would be good for those that are in worse shape than me. Three is ensuring the new King Supers has additional bathrooms as an accommodation request from older Frederickites or Frederickans or, well, let's just go with seniors who live in Frederick. King Supers accommodates older residents with additional bathrooms. She says, I think that's pretty self-explanatory. The one in Firestone has one bathroom. And it's a pain to get to from all the way across if you have, if you're reaching critical mass and you have to go right now. So, and then one other thing, she says, we are helping organize a senior resource fair that will be on the 4th of May, and it will be held in the rec center tentatively from about 9 until 1. And so just to throw that out there, we'll be putting some flyers out and all. So. And the money that we raise will help pay for the costs of a senior fair, senior prom. Play on words because it's for seniors. Okay, thank you very much.
Very kind, thank you. Appreciate all of that feedback very much. Megan, would you mind sharing with the Garcias our funding, community funding request opportunities to see if they could request funding from the board? Thank you. And Kobe is in the room to discuss dog park amenities potentially. Snow plowing, we can get that addressed today as well, yes?
Madam Mayor, on the snowplow specifically, Carbon Valley Parks and Recreation District offers a Snow Buddies program. It's for seniors or those who can't plow their own sidewalks, and that's available through them at no cost every winter. So I can reach out and make sure she gets that contact information for next year. As far as the dog park, we are looking at those types of things around the area. Firestone closing their two dog parks, which they've actually put on pause, was going to put a lot of pressure on our dog park at FRA, so that's something we're kind of expediting.
Sorry. Yeah.
What's that?
How did you spell pause?
I stumble sometimes.
P-A-W-S.
Uh-huh. Pause. Yeah, no, there you go. Gotcha.
They got your own pun.
No pun intended.
Yeah, right.
Anyways, they have to close both of theirs because they're in drainages, and so they've been ordered under their MS4 permit for their stormwater drainage to close both of those.
Got it.
One of them's at Settlers Park, and the other one is by St. Vrain Valley Ranch.
Okay.
So that is something that we definitely will be looking at for next year if we can put in something that is a little bit easier, shorter term, not as high of cost in some of those bigger open spaces that we have, like at Eagle Valley or No Name.
Nobody's. You had a comment. Not what you need.
We signed up and we never heard back.
Never heard back. Okay. All right. Yeah, that would be nice. We'll follow up on that. Thank you. Thank you, Kobe. Very helpful. Okay. Good feedback. Any other public comment? No? All right. Thank you both for your comments and your feedback. We'll move right into our staff reports. Brian, would you kick us off, please?
Yeah, Mayor and trustees, just a couple of highlights I want to bring out. First and foremost,
kudos to the team, Kevin, Jason, Grant. I know we've had people in the community ask about grants, if we get grants, and here's a good example. We get plenty of them. Yeah. This one was with Dr. Cogs, which is Denver Council of Regional Governments. It serves the whole metro area. Southwell was allocated about $2.7 million, and we were awarded a grant for over $2 million of that $2.7 for the Bella Rosa and Colorado Boulevard intersection that we're partnering with Firestone. So a lot of accolades to the team for the work and just the strategic approach and always looking for these things. Again, Kevin, Jason Berg, Sarah, the whole engineering team, you know, we're celebrating Pi Day, and it's important. We appreciate all the hard work that they're doing, as well as Tracy and helping us out with organizing these grants. So the other thing is just some neat things that are going on more internally that you don't always hear. The communications team, and a credit to them, and our Fred Friends Committee, we're working on launching a Fred Thread that's more of a cultural communication each month to continually keep our focus on the values, the things that we're doing good and the things that we always need to work on. In addition to that, we just had our second employer of choice survey come back. So we've got those results as expected, areas that we've improved in and areas we certainly need to get better at. And I think that's the overall intent of all of this. If we're not getting feedback to get better, then we're doing it for the wrong reasons. And so we're excited about that and constantly looking for ways to improve. So with that, I'll take any questions.
What was the match stuff with that grant? I remember reading through it.
Yeah, Kevin, I can't.
It was 20%, and 10% split.
That's a lot of the project was getting paid by that.
Yeah, that's huge, absolutely huge.
Is that something that we're prepared to communicate with the community as of now?
Mm-hmm.
Yes?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, we've been awarded, so we'll get it
official. Okay, ink has dried. Start construction next week.
Yep.
Great. Anyway. Great. That's what I heard.
I need to get around there too.
If I could add, we haven't been awarded, but we still do have some work that'll need to be done in coming up with an IGA with Firestone on, you know, the cost sharing and portions of that agreement. So there is still some paperwork to be done, but this is the first big step on that process. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and if I may just piggyback on the compliments, I spoke to Mayor Whitlow of Mead shortly after, who serves on Dr. Cog board, and she had many compliments of our staff, of the application itself, the presentation. She was very complimentary of the town of Frederick, so well done. Any questions? Tell me a little bit more about Fred Thread. What does that mean?
Yeah, that's an idea that came up through the team, and credit to Renee, our communications, our public information officer, really just trying to continue that message. It's important. Culture is something that you can't, it's an everyday thing where we have personalities. And so we're really just trying to be more intentional with communicating once a month on, hey, remember about family or remember about respect. And here's what's important about respect. This particular month, we're going to be working on respect, and particularly within respect, listening and really making sure that we're doing the best job that we can and listening to one another and to residents and the people that we serve. So it's an important quality.
Thank you for putting that first and foremost. That's important. Okay. Any questions for Brian? Okay, thank you, Brian. Megan.
Thank you, Mayor Kreitz. In your packet is a copy of the town clerk's report. A couple of highlights from that. We are gearing up to start doing the third grade school tours. And I'm excited to share that we actually have an elementary school from Erie that has heard how great our tours are. And they are making a field trip to Frederick to experience local government. So that's very exciting. And our wonderful town attorney is going to be hosting that because I'm on vacation during that time.
Okay.
And then also, Trustee Lamach had inquired about the scholarships. I wanted to give you all an update on that. It closed on the 28th. We had 15 applications. The committee has met and provided feedback on their top candidates. So waiting to hear back on how many we are going to invite to interviews, and that'll happen at the beginning of April. with scholarship awards at the end of April, just in time to make sure that they are honored at senior night and honored at graduation. Yep. So I'd be happy to answer any other questions you may have, but just a couple highlights.
Any questions for Megan?
That's awesome.
Yeah, really great progress. I appreciate being ahead of the timeline on the scholarship committee, mainly because these high schoolers are so dang smart that I am reading their essays 3 and 4 times for inspiration. They're incredible. 15 of them, and there's not one that you'd say, no, thank you. Like, they're incredible. I don't know how this happens for these families in Frederick, but they're doing things right. So it's exciting. Can you give us an update on the Youth Commission? I know that we worked through an ordinance, or we're working through an ordinance. Can you talk through kind of what the next steps on that would maybe be?
Sure. Trustee Brown and I met to kind of develop a framework and then shared with Trustee Padilla, who has provided comments. Jason and I are working together to get an ordinance, hopefully for submittal on the 28th. Or codification into our code, which then will allow for recruitment. And in talking with Trustee Padilla, we're thinking that that may be a separate recruitment from the general commissions because there are so many seats mm-hmm. on that group. But we hope to have that codified and effective by the end of April so that recruitment can happen before school ends.
Great. Fantastic, thank you. Any questions for Megan? No. Very thorough report. Thank you. All right. No other questions. So we'll move into our consent agenda. Our consent agenda are considered to be routine and will be enacted by one motion and vote. There will be no separate discussion of our consent agenda unless a board member so requests, in which case the item may be removed from the consent agenda and considered at the end of the consent agenda. You have several items. Would anyone like to remove any items this evening? If not, some direction on the consent agenda, please.
Madam Mayor, I'd like to request approval of the consent agenda as is.
Second.
Shouldn't it be
as amended?
As is amended.
Amended?
We amended the minutes from February 28th.
Oh, yes.
Yep, but that's okay. You're fine.
Still second.
Trustee Tivaldi?
Yes.
Trustee Brown?
Yes.
Trustee Lamach?
Yes.
Trustee Padilla?
Yes.
Trustee Mayhem?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem March.
Yes.
Motion passes 6-0.
Work. Thank you. We'll move right into action item H. Jason, please.
Good evening, Mayor, Board of Trustees. Before you tonight for consideration is award of the contract for the 2023 Pavement Maintenance Program project. This aligns with the town's strategic plan strategic, reliable, and sustainable infrastructure. And investing in existing and future transportation systems. Bids for the project this year were opened on March 1st, and staff is providing a recommendation for the lowest responsible bidder. This project is part of an ongoing maintenance of town roads, where we follow a five-year cycle to try to address each road every 5 years or as needed, depending on wear and tear. This specific project this year involves patching, mill and overlay, roadway striping, and thermoplastic pavement markings in the areas that are identified in the bid packet and the maps provided. Invitation to bid was issued on February 6th and closed on March 1st. 10 bids were received, and staff is recommending award to Holcomb WCR Incorporated as the lowest qualified bidder. The town attorney has produced the resolution for the award. Financial considerations. The project is valued at $395,000. And between this and the project that was just approved on consent, the SEAL program, which was at $650,000, total program budget is $1,047,000. So it is slightly over the $550,000 allocated. However, we can make this up with cost savings from the Concrete Alley project that was just passed on consent, about $50,000 there, as well as the Colorado Boulevard Mill and Overlay Project, which is not going to move forward this year with development at 52 in Colorado. So with that, if there are any questions, I'd be happy to ask or answer.
Seems like 10 bids is pretty good. Do you feel like you got some really good bidders coming in? We're doing a good job of putting it out there.
Yes. Yeah. We actually got more than 10 bids, but 10 were all that were accepted.
Seems good.
A couple were late.
How, you know what question I'm going to ask, don't you?
I think so.
You think so? How are we doing on that? How are we doing on the GIS mapping on previous roads that we've maintained and the progress
report? I provide those maps too. I have data. If you have GIS, I can share the maps.
Yeah. I'm very lucky that I get to drive on the roads every day, all day. So I would love to see it on the website as soon as possible.
Sure. Are we going to communicate all this information to the neighborhood?
Yeah, I've been working with Angela to update the website. This particular project won't begin until school's out due to a couple of the project areas being directly next to the elementary school on 5th Street. But yeah, that'll go up via the town website and they'll be posting traffic control.
Are we going to only do it through the town website?
We can do it in other means as well through Code Red, do focus areas, door hangers. We can do quite a bit in at least the downtown area.
It would be wise just to promote that and tell them that this is going to happen on this date or whatever, so we're not running into obstacles to get the projects done. There's many neighborhoods that are out there that are going to be impacted. And I'm not sure how long it'll take for those neighborhoods to be done. Like one, Savannah is going to be having the mill and overlay on one road, and then the other roads are going to be chip sealed.
This year they'll be crack sealed.
Crack sealed. Okay, but I'm just saying there's a lot of people in those neighborhoods, and I think we had a. Can we do selective notifications for those?
Yes, yeah, you can do those by geographic location.
I would recommend something like that.
Do you hear that from the community, that they didn't know you were maintaining the road, or they didn't have efficient or ample enough time to move vehicles, or were they prepared? Do you hear that from our community?
I only hear that when somebody's on vacation and we have to work around their car and after the fact. Because typically we notify 72 hours in advance to put no parking signs, those types of work. With a crack seal, I mean, it really doesn't disrupt traffic too much. People can just drive around the car, whichever's putting down the material. When you get into mill and overlay, again, you can drive around. It really doesn't involve a road closure as much. But obviously there's the consideration for two-lane traffic.
I think the opportunity to talk to the people and let them know what's going on is there, and it's another way of opening up that communication with the residents of the town.
Sure.
Thank you.
Do we have any type of an idea of what the history is of the issues that are caused when someone leaves their car out there? Especially, I would think on a mill and overlay would be kind of difficult.
Right, yeah.
How often does that happen? Do you have a hand in?
On a mill and overlay, we have not had that. On a slurry seal, I have. In Summit View a couple years ago, we made 9 news with, you know,
remember that one.
The Brady Bunch car that had to go around.
I do remember that, yeah.
Yeah.
So it's not a consistent problem to where we would have to look at, rather than a 72-hour period, maybe moving it further out. That's the reason I was asking.
Yeah. Being able to post the no parks at least 3 days in advance at least helps notify people. And then if there are issues of people still parked there, the town and PD will sometimes do a door knock, just can you move your car, yes or no? And they've been good to kind of, through their system, they're able to look up a phone number for the person so we can call them if they're at work, say, is somebody home to move it? So we haven't had too many issues, but they do pop up.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions for Jason? No? Okay. Some direction on item H, please.
Okay. Madam Mayor, I would like to ask for approval for resolution number 23R13. A resolution of the Town of Frederick to award a contract for the 2023 pavement maintenance program and authorizing the town manager to execute the contract.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any further discussion?
Trustee Padilla?
Yes.
Trustee Mayhem?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem March?
Yes.
Trustee Lamach?
Yes.
Trustee Tivaldi?
Yes.
Trustee Brown?
Yes.
Motion passes 6-0.
Thank you. We'll move on to action item I, 23R14, with Max, please.
Thank you. I've got a presentation here that I'm going to pop up on a second.
Movies.
Hey, is this TV on or do I need to hit the button? Thank you, thank you. While the projector heats up here and starts turning on, I'll go ahead and start with introductions. I am Max Daffron, our Economic Development Manager. As is tradition, it's a pleasure to see you, Mayor and Board of Trustees. I'm accompanied here by our wonderful Grants Administrator, Tracy, to talk about a target industry cluster study grant application that we've got queued up. We just need some board approval to get that submitted. So real quick, as we always do, we talk about strategic plan alignment and why we're doing what we're doing. The two portions of the strategic plan that this aligns with are community and economic vitality, specifically our main mission statement accompanying that strategic plan item, being a community that fosters economic, recreational, cultural, and environmental vitality and builds upon and enhances the variety of economic opportunities in our community. And additionally, this is also a touching on our strategic plan item of fiscally responsible governance, more specifically 6.2, which is implementing tools to enhance the organizational transparency regarding budget and project performance as evidence to being responsible stewards of valuable public resources. So without further ado, we'll go ahead and get started. Got a presentation outline for you here real quick on, it's real short and sweet this week. I appreciate you putting up with me 2 weeks in a row, so I'll try to keep it short. But we'll talk about what is a target industry cluster study, and we'll talk a little bit about the DOLA Rural Economic Development Initiative grant program and the application we've got in for that. So real quick, what is a target industry cluster study? Real quick, just to bring back the past a little bit, in the work session we held on January 3rd, talking about economic development programs, we talked about increasing data collection and using data-driven decision-making and guiding the work that we do. Specifically, this will relate to our business attraction efforts and our incentive policies as part of the town. And real quick, I will read this part as much as I don't like reading PowerPoint presentations, but what is a target industry cluster study? An industry cluster study is defined as groups of similar and related firms in a specific geographic area that share common markets, technologies, worker skill needs, which are often linked by buyer-seller relationships. So what this is looking at the businesses we have in town and the whole economic ecosystem that surrounds it. So you're looking at not only businesses with accompanying uses, but people who are in the related supply chain, related skill sets, and how those all intertwine together, and it helps build you a stronger economy as a community. And so real quick, why are cluster studies important? Like I mentioned earlier, that they help strengthen that ecosystem, that economic ecosystem. It gives us a targeted approach on how we approach businesses when we're trying to attract primary employers into the town. So for example, you know, it would tell us specifically, you don't have any businesses in X industry, so don't waste your trying to drive this one type of user. For example, you know, a project we've had recently with the Agilent expansion for Agilent Technologies, you know, a cluster study would come back and say, biosciences is a huge component of your local economy, not only with this operator, but with these other ancillary uses in Boulder and Lafayette and Fort Collins and all the other communities and how this business ecosystem works together. So it would behoove you as a community to use your attraction efforts towards bringing in these specific type users. So it helps us be more targeted in what we're doing, and it serves as an actually very effective business attraction tool as well. And of course, one of the things I always like to talk about, it's part of our continued efforts at building consistency in how we're approaching our business community and specifically businesses to attract.
And while Max is taking a drink real quick, I just want to point out that I think it's important you have synergy in the town of Frederick right now with a company we brought in, the board, the first economic development policy with Golden Triangle Construction, who has helped, I believe, Hirsch
Precision Products.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So two Frederick businesses helping each other out.
I love that. So would the, and not to, you know, steal the next slides, I'm not sure, but would the industry cluster also provide, you know, complementary services to like biosciences? So it would identify that Agilent may use the XYZ type of other complementary businesses, and that might be a benefit to attract.
That is 100% correct. For example, in a previous community I worked for in years past, Boeing was a major employer in the community, and we had literally hundreds of small ancillary businesses that would produce one component that Boeing would utilize. But these businesses would locate in that community to be near that business. And that's how that whole ecosystem kind of works together. So to jump right back in, target industry clusters look at strengths beyond our own borders. This picture on the slide here is of the Metro Denver Economic Development Corporation 9-county region. The town of Frederick is a member, along with a plethora of other communities in the metro region. But Metro Denver EDC has identified 9 target industries: aerospace, aviation, bioscience, broadband, energy, financials, food and beverage production, health and wellness, and IT software. So that's for the entire 9-county region, and that'll make sense why I'm bringing this up with the next slide when we talk about the NOCO Ready, which is the Northern Colorado Regional Economic Development Initiative, which the town is also involved with. I actually sit as the chair of this organization for as a representative of the town of Frederick this year. And NOCO Ready, which is Weld County and Larimer County, has their target industries, which you'll notice are a little bit different. So you've got bioscience and medical devices, distribution and e-commerce, fabrication and production of technology and manufacturing of that technology, food processing and manufacturing, information technology, and plastics. So the goal with this study really is to take a closer look at our strengths as a community and how we relate between the two metro, between the NOCO Ready and between the Metro Denver Economic Development Corporation, and where we sit in our ecosystem as a community, in our economic ecosystem, and how we can really strengthen it, which helps tremendously with economic resiliency if you, you know, if there's an economic downturn or things like that, but also helps us stand on our own 2 feet when we're going out and targeting businesses directly on why you should come to Frederick. So real quick, information about the grant. The DOLA Rural Economic Development Initiative grant is available for use in technical assistance type projects. The town is asking in this grant application for a $25,000 match and one-on-one matching funds. If awarded, funds are available by July of this year, and we included funding for the match in our budget request for this year, knowing that we would want to complete one of these projects for the town. And I say staff is engaged with DOLA, our wonderful grants administrator Tracy is engaged with DOLA preliminarily to talk about our application, see if this is the type of thing they're looking for, and they've expressed excitement to the town in that application use. So hopefully we get awarded. Staff recommendations really quickly. You know, in the packet, there was an accompanying resolution, which was approved by the town attorney. So we would ask that the Frederick Economic Development Office and the Grant Administrator's Office seek board approval for the accompanying resolution in your packet for the submission and execution of all affiliated grant documents should the town be awarded the grant for the target industry cluster study from the Department of the Colorado Department of Local Affairs in the amount of $25,000. Sorry, a giant word salad there. I apologize for that. I apologize. I drank this iced tea. I'm all caffeined up, apparently, in the afternoon. alternatives, Board of Trustees, of course, could direct economic development staff to not pursue grant matching for the target industry cluster study. And with that, I'll turn it over to the Mayor and Board of Trustees for any additional questions. I apologize if I talk too fast.
Actually, I didn't understand any of it. Could you do it again? Teasing. Any questions for Max?
I think it's exciting that you're the chair of the organization.
Yeah.
It's very exciting.
Pretty cool.
Yeah. Very cool.
Frederick's getting a lot of notice. I certainly can't take credit for it. I'm the new guy here, but it really says a lot from the work that the board has done to encourage our proactive and intentional economic development efforts. It really says a lot. And Frederick is becoming very respected by our economic development partners in the community.
It's also exciting to see that we're getting more and more grants with the aid of Tracy.
She's marvelous. She does fantastic work. Very knowledgeable.
Her ears were ringing.
Tracy, we're talking about how great you are.
I'm on it.
Right.
And I think that kind of effort really benefits the town. We've seen it on a couple of different incidences tonight where those things can really help the community and realize the community can realize the benefits of these grants.
Absolutely. It really opens up a lot of opportunities for us as a community.
Two questions for you, if you don't mind, from my perspective. One, do you know the success rate of DOLA providing a grant for industry cluster studies?
Andy?
I'm not sure.
Sometimes they don't share what other people are applying for, too. I always try to probe for that.
Yeah.
But it's a lot of it is tied to job creation. So a lot of the narrative for the grant, which it was included in your packet, talks about building that stronger economical ecosystem for our community. It really does help. We have a very robust business base here in the town to begin with. And this is one of those programs that I believe we've demonstrated in the application as well. It will really help make that even stronger and help our employees in Frederick and our residents that live here as well have an opportunity to live where they work and work where they live.
Oh, I can see that.
And I think another thing DOLA is probably fairly excited about is we haven't been getting a lot of these grants over the years. And so we're kind of
applying for them.
And so in my experience working with DOLA over the last decade or so has been, they're really excited to see new communities getting involved in the process so that they can partner with us and provide these opportunities as opposed to the same dozen that are always at the table asking for money.
Yeah. I think my next question is not necessarily reasonable at the time that we're at, but you know what, we've been talking the last couple years in Frederick about plans. We have a lot of master plans in play. We've taken a lot of time to be diligent and thoughtful and plan the future of Frederick. So what will you do with the results of an industry cluster study? I mean, what actions will you take immediately in a short term and long term? How do they benefit? What's your plan?
Yeah, absolutely. In the short term, an industry cluster study is very effective for guiding day-to-day attraction incentive policy, right? We have our key industries listed as well, which we're not going to change any of those unless we wouldn't come before the board, but this really gives us backing if we want to talk about, well, we're going to be deliberate in attracting bioscience, so we're going to be really diligent in attracting advanced plastics manufacturing or things like that. That is in the short term. In the long term, communities do things like cluster studies as part of a greater economic development strategic plan or something like that. And I've seen that done in the past, and if that's the direction that we would need to go in at some point, always, as we're building our economic development programs, things here at the town, you know.
Is that, if that's the case, you know, does the company or whoever does the study itself, do they reach out to current stakeholders or current industries and have that discussion with them?
Yes, they do. They actually work with businesses in the area. It's not just like, you know, somebody playing on Google Maps and like looking, oh, we see all these guys match up. They actually reach out and get relatively in I don't want to say in the weeds, because in the weeds always implies like in the weeds, but they get they actually dig deeper to find out why these people are here, what brought them here, what's, you know, important factors for locating these businesses here. We don't just go, oh, well, you have one large biomedical manufacturer, so you should do this. It talks about all the little ancillary things that go on besides that. So,
fantastic. Thank you.
Yeah.
Max, perhaps a follow-up question is, what does this do to provide us with information so that we can interface with these industries? As opposed to saying, yeah, I'll go talk to these people.
Mm-hmm.
Having this does what to help us talk?
Oh, yes. And thank you for teeing that up for me there, Jason. It having this document in place, like, for example, when you go and meet with a prospect that's in X industry, I not only I can say all day that, oh, you're going to love the town of Frederick. It's great. We've got this incentive program, yada, yada, yada. I actually can come with documentation that says your business will have a better chance of being successful in this area because you have suppliers that are nearby. You have people who are potential buyers of your product nearby. You have the correct, you know, the correct talent pool nearby. It actually helps us really make that pitch as part of a hard document that we have that we can bring to these attraction meetings and actually work with our business communities and like I said earlier, be deliberate about why you should be here versus somewhere else.
How long can we expect the information to kind of be valid? I mean, it's got to be a good 5 years or more, right?
Yeah, it's something, you know, some organizations look at every 5 years. I've seen some organizations do it a little longer than that. A lot of times you want to do it when there's been a change in the market and change in operators and things like that. Because if I do the same report this year and I do it again next year, it's going to be like, well, you have X number of people in this other industry. Your main industry clusters are still relatively similar, but you want to do it when you have, kind of large market-driven forces that have, you know, washed through the community, so to say. Like, for example, a great example will be the Agile expansion announcement. It's a fantastic opportunity for us to do that because we can talk about what's not only what's here but what's coming and what else is in that ecosystem to support it.
And some of the same talking points that encourage them to
exactly.
Yeah, that's helpful. Thank you. Any other questions for Max? Not some direction on item I, please.
Madam Mayor, I'd like to request approval of resolution number 23R14, approving support for a grant application and related contracts for conducting a target industry cluster study.
Second.
Trustee Brown?
Yes.
Trustee Tivaldi?
Yes.
Trustee Mahan?
Yes.
Trustee Padilla?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem March?
Yes.
Trustee Lamach?
Yes.
Motion passes 6-0.
Thank you for your time, Board.
Thank you, Max.
Thank you.
Good to see you.
Good to see you, too.
Action item J, Autumn, please. Are you all doing okay? Anybody need a recess? Are you doing all right?
Good? Well, I think we're doing all right.
Are you doing semi all right?
About half full.
Okay.
Town clerk, little assistance.
Ethan. There we go.
My apologies, but I am new to our system and protocol.
Oh, that's okay.
But I will get it.
Now I know your password.
Dot.
It's password.
Password 1. Well, this boots up. Let me first introduce myself. I'm Autumn Gonzalez, the senior planner of the town of Frederick. I've been here about 5 months now. I'm very excited to be before you tonight in person and all of you. I have not met some of you, so hello and thank you for welcoming me to Frederick. Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh.
This is testing your cybersecurity awareness skills right here, right now.
How many clicks?
We're here. All right. So this agenda item
contains two separate action items between two different boards. The first item is a waiver request before the Board of Trustees. If the waiver is approved, then there's a second request, and that's a variance. They'll go before the Board of Adjustment. I'm only going to present the waiver request at this time. The applicant is proposing to install a 10-foot battery-charged 7,000-volt electric fence at 4180 Bush Place. Currently, the land use code prohibits electric fencing. Our land use code does allow applicants to apply for a waiver to any and all code provisions. So that's why we're here tonight. The applicant is wanting to get a waiver to permit that electric fence. The applicant is Amarok LLC, and the owner is 4180 Bush Place LLC. The property is located at the northeast intersection of East I-25 Frontage Road and Bella Rosa Parkway. It's located in the Bear Industrial Park subdivision. Cruise America RV Sales and Rental operates out of an existing 9,800 square foot building on the site. The site also contains a parking lot of around 17 spaces and a large display sales storage area to the east of that building. Outdoor storage is located to the north of this property. To the west, there is a trucking facility. To the south, vacant property, and to the east, there's a water treatment facility. The property is zoned industrial, and all adjacent property is also zoned industrial. This property has gone through many land use development processes over the years. Starting in 2018, a site plan was approved for office and warehousing uses. In 2020, there was a site plan amendment that reduced the site plan from two buildings down to one building. In 2022, last year, a conditional use was approved for auto, RV, boat, and truck sales. That would be the Cruise America business. And also in 2022, there was a site plan amendment that approved some adjustments for that user. The picture you see here shows that 9,800 square foot building and security fencing around the display sales storage area. That fencing is wood and it's 6 feet in height. The applicant provided a site plan showing where the electric fence is proposed. That's shown here in red. I would like to clarify that the proposal calls for a second fence. So there's an existing wood fence, and this electric fence would be located within that 6 foot tall wooden fence. It'd be separated by, I believe, 4 to 8 inches. But just for clarity, it would be a second fence. This diagram shows the details of that electric fence and the warning signs that are proposed to be placed along the fence, showing 7,000 volts. And lastly, the applicant provided some photos of what that fence would look like. Again, 10 feet tall and electric. With every land use development process, there's a list of criteria found in our land use code by which staff reviews the application or request. This slide shows that list. I'm not going to go into great detail with each item. I did provide my analysis in the staff report. Staff does not believe that this request meets several of these listed items. Therefore, staff is recommending denial of this waiver request. Staff did discuss our recommendation with the applicant and owner, and they did choose to move forward tonight with this request. As you can see here, I've provided several recommended motions for the board to consider. I also listed these in my staff reports. That pretty much concludes my presentation for this waiver request. The applicant will now come up and speak. Afterwards, both staff and the applicant will be available for questions.
Can you just go back to the one the page before this?
Sure.
Just leave it there. For sure.
Thank you, Autumn. Would you introduce your applicant, please?
I'll introduce myself.
Hi.
Great. My name is Michael Pate. I'm with Amarok. I live in Columbia, South Carolina at 315 South Maple Street, and we work out of 550 Assembly Street in Columbia, South Carolina. That's world headquarters. Let me give you a little primer here on exactly what these devices are. These are alarms and security systems. So what we do is we use a 12-volt battery. We're never connected to the electrical infrastructure at all. We keep those batteries powered with solar panels. That's all it is. We take that 12 volts and it goes into an energizer. That energizer amplifies that 12 volts to 7,000 volts in 1.1 second. Once that energizer is loaded, it has to release that energy down the interior line. In 3/10,000ths of a second, we do a perimeter check. Back to an alarm panel. That alarm panel is looking for a nice clean return. Clean return in our little world is between 2 and 4,000 volts. When you get a negative return, the alarm panel is activated. If we get 5 consecutive negative returns, we activate the alarm. It goes off audibly on the site and silently back to our command center or our call center where we start going through a call list. So I've got Chris and Roger here also. They're the owner and GM of these of this business in the land. We'll go through the call list with those folks. Hey guys, we've got a break on the northern perimeter, 220 feet from the northeast corner. What do you want to do? We also associate cameras with these devices. So you can sit home at 2:30 in the morning in the middle of a snowstorm and look out there and go, hey, we had a tree fall over on the corner and knocked everything down. Let's just button it up and go back to bed. Or I got 5 guys in a flatbed truck. They're robbing me blind. Please call the local police department. That's a verified alarm. In my experience, police like verified alarms and know where to go and what to expect. So that's basically what we do. We are a little taller than your code allows. Your code allows a device or whatever we are to go up to, I think, 6 or 8 feet before, I think it's 8 feet here, before, you know, you start saying no. So we're a little taller than that. We're 10 feet. That's basically the industry standard. It's pretty simple. If you have a fence and we have ours behind it, they're just going to step over it and drop in and start stealing stuff. If we go up this tall, they're not going to do it. No one's jumping over 10 feet. We force everybody down to the bottom of the ground to make them try to break through there. And when they do that, they're going to hit the fence and they're going to come back. These devices are tested and labeled to the international and national standards for these devices. So we actually have our manufacturing facility. We go through an audit every year with a nationally recognized testing laboratory to make sure that our devices are safe and reliable. So it's a 12-volt battery, keeps folks out, never have to call the police. These guys don't have to worry about their stuff and their trucks being stolen anymore. You know, we really don't fit into your code. I mean, part of the whole thing here is that the specific provisions of your code don't actually cover what we do. And that's fairly typical, and we call ourselves the purple squirrel. We just don't fit in that little bailiwick that everyone else has going on with security systems, alarms, and fences. We just don't fit. So that's why we have to come to these hearings and try to get waivers and or variances depending on where we are. If you have any questions at all, I'd love to answer them. We would ask that you grant the waiver so these folks can protect their property. If you have any questions at all from them about their property and the crime they've encountered here, be glad to bring them up too.
Questions for Amarok, correct?
Correct.
Amarok? I have a question for you.
Yes, ma'am.
It's pretty common for electric fences not to be allowed in zoning. Like you said, you don't fit often. So where have you been successful in getting various?
Well, I've got hundreds of them in Colorado. Around here, I've got them in Aurora, Denver, Adams County, Wheat Ridge, Commerce City, and a few others. That's just in your metro area here. Denver's a little unusual because I go through the fire department. I don't go through building and zoning or electrical at all. I go through the fire department. So they're a little odd on the way they handle it. But everyone else, I go through building to do it. Electrical doesn't seem the need to do that because we're a 12-volt battery. You know, no one's going to go out and basically get a permit for a 12-volt battery in your car or your boat or whatever. And that's what we're doing here. So we're basically not even covered by the National Electric Code. The National Electric Code exempts anything under 50 volts. As the primary power source, we're under 50 volts. So we have tons of these here. I've got 6,000 or more all over the country. Yes, sir.
So you're basically saying that we're defining it as an electrical fence, but it's really not. It's a security system?
It's a perimeter security system and alarm.
Its intent is to not shock somebody to keep them out.
Pardon me?
Its intent is not to shock somebody to
keep them out. Oh, no, it'll shock you. And the shock is this. Let's say you have your stocking feet on, you're running across the carpet in the middle of the winter, reach out and hit your door handle, bam. That's a 15 to 20,000 volt static shock. I'm half of that.
What kind of issues are we having with?
I'll defer to the owners here on that. All right.
What kind of issues are we having?
I didn't hear the question.
Roger, go ahead and introduce yourself.
I'm Roger Wingerberg. I'm the owner of the building at 4180.
What kind of issues are you having criminally? I want to break into what?
Criminally, before Cruise America set up shop and we had all the lighting and all the different security systems, we'd been broken into twice. Vehicles were stolen both times. One of the vehicles was finally reclaimed in Denver. The other, they drove a block and found another vehicle they liked better, abandoned mine, and stole another one. So that's kind of where we're at. The area has had some criminal effect, mainly around the catalytic converter, and I'm sure everybody's heard about that issue. And that is really the big issue. And we've had Toyota and Lexus, I think, both have a little bit of problem in that area. Our one issue, we're packed pretty tight back there. So literally cameras, even somebody standing by the fence just may not see anybody back there. So it'd be nice to have a deterrent.
And that's part of the fence problem, because they have a hard wooden fence that basically covers everything in there. That's not a very good security measure. If I was doing it, I'd have chain links so I can see through the whole thing. But that's just me. Just so you know, you can look through there without having to actually go into the property. But that being said, that's what's already built there. So it's very difficult to maintain security in that particular site with that type of fencing there.
Mr. Wingerberg, can I grab your address for the record, please?
10189 Foxfire in Firestone. I'm sorry, should have given that up front.
Any board questions for Mr. Wingerberg or Amarok at this point? No? There might be additional questions, if you don't mind
sticking around. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Autumn, would you mind joining us for a few more questions, please?
Pardon?
Would you mind joining us for a few more questions?
Absolutely.
Any questions for staff on this item?
Is anywhere in the code, does it have a definition of what an electric fence is?
Trustee Tivaldi, I don't believe so.
Autumn, I have a few questions. Go ahead, Trustee Lamarck, if you have one right now, it's fine.
How many electric alarm systems like this do we have within the city currently?
Good question, Trustee Lamarck. Yeah. I don't believe we have any. Our code prohibits them, and we have not approved a waiver for them.
Can I ask what the concern about if something like this was approved, what sort of precedence then it would? I know you said that is one of the concerns. Can we discuss maybe what that would be? I don't know if that's okay. Yeah, okay.
Great, that's a good question, Trustee Tivaldi. So if this were to be approved, then other businesses in the area, in the industrial zone, could install this type of fencing. Would it be 10 feet tall? I don't know. That depends on the variance. But we're going to set a precedence for all developers to come in and seek waivers to this provision. And that opens the door for waivers to other provisions if this is approved. Staff looked at the character of the neighborhood, the character of Frederick. What does this say to our community? Staff believes there are other ways to secure this property without using a charge that The intent is to shock people, to physically harm them. When we went through this criteria, if you look at criteria number one, is it detrimental to the public good? Absolutely, it causes physical harm. So there are many ways we approach this. Again, precedence is really big in the planning world. If you open the door, how do you close it? And it's a big one for us.
But my guess would be, as you're thinking that, you know, then it's going to lead into, well, okay, you approved this 7,000 volt thing, and now somebody wants to just put a 10,000 volt, you know, a true, you know, electric fence that you could bump against. And, you know, I mean, is that kind of where some of the thought is going?
That would...
We'd still have to approve every one, right?
Yes.
That would involve staff doing more research and coming up with codes to set parameters. There's a lot that goes into an approval, and you're correct.
I don't want to go down that path.
10,000, 15,000, where does it stop? I would like to read a sentence from their statement of intent, if that's okay. There was uncertainty whether or not there was a shock involved, and they did state it's a pulsed electric charge. The safety of the shock is not advertised. Due to our inherent fear of electricity, most criminals will not take a chance on breaching the perimeter. So the intent is to shock them. And again, staff believes that goes against criteria number one.
I don't believe you could answer this, but there's a fellow standing back there with a badge on his chest on there. And I have a question. If we can, is there any way we could get some input as to the rates of crime that we have in this area? Have they increased? Is it a bad area in that respect, or would you know?
We pulled some stats for Autumn. Thanks. Specific to this business, and since they've been there, we have had no reported incidents at that business. However, there is, you have it written down here. Two incidents. Were motor vehicle thefts in 2021 and early 2022, and one incident was a trespass in 2019. All these were prior to the RV sales. There are burglaries out there. It's an industrial park. They do break through fences, and we have had that in the past. So as a percentage or rate, it's not a ton for that area. But
it
does happen.
Yeah, it obviously world we live in that would happen, but this area is not above or has more crime in it than some of the other areas where we have industrial parks?
Not necessarily. Our industrial parks are pretty even across the board. I mean, they are right along I-25, so that increases some theft issues just a little bit, but overall as a whole, it's not a overall major concern for us because it's not happening a lot.
All right.
Fairly sporadic. Yeah.
Hey, thank you.
Commander Glantz, if you were knowing the line of work that you do and the crime that you address, is this a reasonable deterrent from a burglar, someone looking to steal an RV, or are there potentially other ways into this fence that they would take from your professional opinion and experience?
Yeah, honestly, I've been doing this going on 22 years now, and I haven't come across anything like this as a deterrent anywhere I've worked in the past. So wanted to be some training for us on how we respond to these type of incidents, and this is something we can bypass and gain access to if there is an alarm out there. I'm assuming that the signs may deter just because of the unknown of what the shock will be. That one, it's hard to say. I don't know what the success rate would be on that. So, yeah.
Nope. Thanks, Commander Glenn. Thank you.
Autumn, is there a reason that we don't see an application or presence from Cruise America in this option?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. So, this is an interesting one. It's my understanding Amarok is they're the applicant, they're the fencing company for Cruise America. Cruise America wants security, so the applicant's proposing this request. A little odd for me as well, but anyone can be an applicant if the owner agrees.
Okay. Do you know if at other locations that Cruz America occupies, they use this sort of fence?
My name is Chris McGee. I live at 5441 Link Street here in Frederick. We moved up from North Denver. We were at 8950 Federal Boulevard. We did not have this type of deterrent at our old location, which is kind of why we are looking at doing this now. This was a little bit before my time with the company. About two summers ago, we came in one day. We, not me, the company came in. Seven catalytic converters had been cut out and stolen from our RVs. So the problem with that, and this is more my concern as the general manager of this building, it's not so much the RV itself being stolen. We have policies and procedures that we do to make sure that doesn't happen. It's more the catalytic converters specifically that are my biggest concern. If you go to our lot right now, it's a gold mine for anybody that wants them. About 45% of my fleet right now has two catalytic converters on it per vehicle. They are packed tightly, so if you wanted to get in there, it's fairly dark, kind of off the beaten path, but close to I-25, it'd be very easy to get that, throw them over the fence if we didn't have this deterrent in place. They'd be able to get in, throw them over the fence, load up a truck, however they want to do it, and take off. To answer the question directly, no, we didn't have this, you know, this deterrent at our old location, but in certain aspects, we wish we did. Cruz America has been in business for 50 years. We're all across the nation up in Canada. Every single one of our stores has been hit with catalytic converter being stolen. So that's kind of the biggest reason.
Very helpful.
Problems like this down in your old location?
Yes, we did. Like I said, I wasn't there for it, but I believe it was two summers ago. So not this last summer, summer before that. We had seven catalytic converters stolen overnight. The downfall of that is, you know, it wouldn't be a huge deal. I had a quote to replace the catalytic converter today, not because it was stolen, it just went out. That quote is, depending on the vehicle, between $1,500 and $2,000 each time that we pay when that happens. 50% of my customers come from overseas. They're all international customers. Spend a lot of money to go on vacation and tour the United States. Part of the reason we came up into Frederick is because it gives them access to the open area, whether they go north, west, south, or east. When we get into the summertime, we're going to be really, really busy. So I'll have, you know, right now I've got 137 vehicles sitting on my lot tonight. During the summertime, I might have three or four. Well, I might also have 10 departures that day, that following day, let's say. I'm waiting on vehicles to come back in, get them ready to get them sent out that afternoon. If I lose four or five vehicles because of catalytic converters, I can't send them out, you know, on rental. So that really puts us in a bind. And now I've got two, three other renters who I don't have a vehicle for, and there's nothing I can do about it. That typically will ruin their vacation, which is why, to me, the catalytic converter is the biggest issue. I mean, if something goes down, if something breaks, we can usually fix it. A catalytic converter, not that quick and easy. Yes, sir.
My question revolves around limiting potentially how often the system is operating. So, I mean, it seems as if this would only be a thing at night, correct? That during the day, this system would be completely shut off and nobody touching it would ever get shocked unless the thing has... Nobody's working there. Nobody's there. It's nighttime. I mean, is that an accurate?
And that is typical. About the only places that they're operating 24/7 is if you have like a cross dock and a trucking cross dock where you've got all the trailers lined up in the back and you've got everyone trying to unload on that dock and move product through the docks. Their backs are turned. They can't see anything. So in this particular instance, yes, it would be off because it's actually a retail operation, so it's going to be off during business hours. And we actually guard probably about 50 of their sites right now. I just don't guard the one in Denver, and I don't guard the one here. But I have 50 of their sites that I already guard.
That was helpful context. Thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. any other questions for the applicant or staff?
My question would be, is there a way if that we approve something like this that we could put some parameters on it, like that the thing can only be operated at night or between these hours? And the specific thing for me is that this is a very specific use for this. It would have to be tied to this user alone. And if this user quits using this place, that fence goes away. I mean, is there stuff we can tie to that?
Thank you for that question, Trustee DiValdi. You may approve it with conditions. That is an option.
That would be tied to, like, the permit to operate that place, right? So that's correct. If somebody came in to operate it in a different capacity, it would have to be gone through again.
Tied to the building, not the business.
Or,
can I answer that question for you?
Maybe.
Maybe.
Okay. Well, can you join us at the podium, please? Sure. Thank you.
Our business model is this. We're basically operating an alarm system, so it's a monthly fee. And when they're gone, I'm taking out all the guts of the whole thing, because the most important thing to me is the energizer and all the electronics on that solar array. That's the heart of it. So I don't want it sitting out there with no one worrying, with no one touching it.
But you know, our problem is that if it's not down on paper, we can't enforce it.
Well, you can put it on paper. I'm fine with that condition. We got no problem with that. But as a practical matter, I'm not leaving it out there, because it's literally tens of thousands of dollars worth of equipment that I'm not going to leave out there.
Thank you.
Trustee DiValdi, if I may, from an internal processing standpoint, Cruise America has a business license with the town. If they were to depart the town, any new business would need to apply for that license. What that triggers is a response from the clerk's office, which is to send that application to the planning department, the building department, fire district. And so that's when those reviews of that property would happen, and planning would immediately trigger, oh, the board approved this conditionally, and it's not authorized for the next business. So then the clerk's office would then hold them to that and say, we're not issuing your business until this is removed.
Perfect. That's exactly the answer I wanted. Thanks.
I have a question for Autumn. So we have a lot of auto sales and businesses along I-25 with cars, right? And I think you mentioned staff. In staff's opinion, there are other options for security for our businesses, you know. So what can we go into detail on what some other businesses use for security? And, you know, maybe Commander Glantz would, you know that too.
Sure. Thank you for that question, Trustee Padilla. I will say that our fencing requirements for screen fencing, solid fencing, permit heights of, I believe, up to 7 feet. Their existing fence is 6 feet, so they could go higher and meet our code. Other uses around I-25 have taller fencing.
What?
Taller fencing. You know, they max out at the 7 feet. We do have several around town. I can't tell you how many, but I have seen that use pop up around Frederick.
The taller fences.
Sorry?
You've seen the use of the taller fences.
Yes, that's correct. Okay. If I may add something, Madam Mayor. So tonight we heard from PD, and in my staff report, I listed all the incidences for this property that are prior to this business. This business has no incidents since it opened, none. The applicant is talking about if it happens, not because it's happened. I would just like to make that statement. Thank you.
Get that, thank you. Rock and roll, everybody? Have your questions answered? Do you all need a moment? I'll request a recess, please, about 5 minutes, please, and we'll join each other in just a moment. Thank you. crime maps just to see where there's burglaries, larcenies, things like that. So I wanted to give him a moment to look at that. I will also note we do have our land use attorney as well as our in-house attorney available if you have any questions, Board of Trustees, or if either of you gentlemen, our legal counsel, have any questions, comments, or concerns you'd like to share right now would be a good time.
Todd Messenger, Special Land Use Counsel. Just so the board is aware, you know, in order to grant the waiver, you have to find that each and every one of those criterion has been satisfied. we would note that the project was approved last year at this site, at the choice of the applicant, with the fencing that was on the site plan. So this application suggests that the site, based on the applicant's representation, that the site is an ideal location for crime. The site that the applicant, not the applicant, but that the owner selected last year for this site, and that the that the site plan wasn't adequate to deal with the security issues that they might face at the site. But again, you know, the one of the standards, and the reason why that's relevant is one of the standards is that the situation can't be a self-inflicted circumstance. So as you go through it, you can still find potentially that there's a there's no self-inflicted circumstance. Maybe things have changed or whatever. You know, but you would have to make that finding among you to satisfy that criterion.
The only thing I would add to the conversation, Trustee DeVeldi asked whether or not electronically charged fences is something that's defined in the code. Autumn's correct that we don't have a definition of that. The section that refers to this as prohibited materials says that along with razor wire, barbed wire is prohibited. It does provide one caveat, which is electric barrier fencing installed and used with transmitter collar worn by dogs for the purpose of maintaining dog owners within the owner and keeper's premises shall be permitted. So it kind of gives you the idea of taken in context, what is an electronically charged fence would be anything electric with the exception that's specifically called out of a dog fence, invisible fencing, to kind of give you the gambit of what was originally intended in the drafting of this section. Certainly something that we'll look at addressing in our future land use code, though, with more clarity.
Thank you. That's the tough part. Yeah. There's always gray matter, as there should be, right?
I wear gray suits.
Nice.
That's right, gray areas.
Okay, you all have had time to consider. If you have any further questions, I ask that you ask those now. If not, I would look to you all for some direction, please. You will, once there is a motion, regardless of the motion, you have an opportunity to discuss, so keep that in mind.
Madam Mayor, I move to deny the request for a variance for case number. I move to deny, let's see.
23R14.
To deny the waiver, case number 2023-01. I move that it be denied based on the following findings of fact, that it did not meet the criteria listed on the page before, and to direct the town attorney to reduce this denial, along with the findings of fact, to writing for prompt execution by Mayor Kreitz without further action from the board.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any further discussion?
I'd like to discuss the fact that I totally want people to be able to protect their stuff, but given the way the code says you have to meet all of those, there's no way I could say that that's a nice thing to drive into town and you see a big giant security fence, you know. I mean, that's the one that's tough for me, but I'd love to give them, you know, there's other opportunities of other ways to protect things, and I hope that we're not messing things up with that, but.
In terms of discussion too, I, you know, just want to talk to the applicant and the business that definitely have empathy for the crime and catalytic converters and the crime against vehicles. And, you know, with our police department, I'm sure you see that, you know, throughout the community and throughout the Denver metro area. I mean, we have a problem with that in our state. And so, you know, would encourage you to get the solution that you need to protect your property. Just in our town of Frederick, my discussion, my belief is that this is not the way to do it in Frederick.
I want to add a little point of discussion also, Mom, for on a denial. When you look at this area, there's no evidence of increased crime in this area. There's no evidence of increased crime on the car lots that run up and down I-25 in here. They're not reporting anything. And I just don't think this is necessary. I agree with what Trustee DeFelde said also.
I can't disagree with anything that anybody's already said.
Any further discussion?
Just a quick one. So if you have a motion to deny, then you vote yes to deny it, right? Okay. Sorry, I'm only on
the do that very often. Correct. Yes.
Madam Mayor,
yes,
and Board, if I could also just suggest and encourage Cruise America to work with, you know, Commander Glances here, as well as, you know, I'm sure that the PD would be more than welcome to look at and recommend suggestions, do a security audit. There are things out there that other businesses utilize that are helpful for them in terms of dealing with crime and tracking down crime. And so I certainly recommend to, and we're happy to put them in touch and have a collaborative partnership with our police department.
And I'll add too that, I mean, if this is something that we want to allow here, we're gonna have to change our code to allow it, because I mean, the waiver thing, anyway, that's my point too.
Yeah. Certainly a point of conversation when we're talking about land use codes and all the updates, the comprehensive plan, but the plan itself needs to represent the greater good in the town of Frederick, and that's what these criteria are for. So, okay, you have a motion on the floor. Any further discussion? We call the vote, please.
Trustee Mahan?
Yes.
Trustee Brown?
Yes.
Trustee Padilla?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem March?
Yes.
Trustee Tivaldi?
Yes.
Trustee Lamack?
Yes.
Motion passes 6-0.
Great, thank you. Thank you, Autumn. Thank you to our applicants. Appreciate it. We will move right into trustee reports. Paper. Anyone want to start us off? Trustee reports? No? Yes?
I have nothing. I'd like to say it's very nice to be here in person again.
Yeah. Yeah, you've been out and about.
I hope it doesn't mess things up too much when I go remote. It works okay. I just feel like I miss a little bit of a conversation here and there.
Yeah. You miss our presence.
Right. And would that's you, exactly yeah, right. Yeah. And would you know that Kevin has blue hair?
No, but, well,
if you're virtual.
If you can see it really good in the dark, too. So.
That's funny. That's good. Thank you. Anything over here? No? No? Couple quick items. It sounds like next week we have a work session that a few trustees have mentioned they're unable to attend. In that work session, we had planned the town clerk's annual evaluation. I would appreciate having a full board for that participation. So we have a couple of options that I would recommend. We could cancel the work session next Tuesday, then move that evaluation to either April 4th, where we do have a few items that we're already working through, snowplow being one of them. I do not remember the additional item.
Water dedication requirements,
okay. Or we have a April 18th work session available that there is nothing planned as of yet. So are we comfortable potentially moving the town clerk annual evaluation to one of those dates? Okay. Would you like it on a date where there are other matters to consider or separate? That would help me.
Separate.
It can be hard to, you know.
Separate.
I don't want to stay till 1 o'clock if we're talking about snowplows.
Yeah. No, we're not. We're not staying till 1 o'clock.
No, we have recommendations, a level of service, and it'll really just be a discussion.
Yeah, I think the 18th is fine.
Yes.
Okay. April 18th. I appreciate that. So we'll cancel the work session planned for next Tuesday. Sound reasonable? Happy spring.
Megan, can I ask for that evaluation? If you could have a memo on the status updates for your goals.
Thank you. Goals. That would be great. Thank you. Other item, if you don't mind, Brian, would you mind sharing? Between you and I, we tend to get a series of emails from a resident on Rowe Street. I am concerned that their concern is now growing into a neighborhood concern or a community concern. Would you please update the board on what our code enforcement team has been working through on that concern of the resident, please?
Madam Mayor and members of the board, we have had, I think it's been going on for about 3 or 4 months. We have, and Commander Glantz, help me, I'm trying to find the email. I believe it's over by, is it the business park? Nonetheless, and I'll correct you on the location, we've had some complaints of junk vehicles, unregistered vehicles, people sleeping in vehicles, abutting a neighborhood that's close to a storage area. And so we have had the code compliance team out there numerous times. Just this over the weekend, they issued, I think, 3 or 4 additional warnings, and we'll also be addressing any type of, if there's people sleeping in vehicles. It is a concern, growing concern for that neighborhood, as is, there's a lot of junk in that area that's emanating from that storage area. And so we're working hard with the owner to get compliance, obviously, to push education and try to clean up that area. So I know the team has been very active. We've been communicating with the residents. I know that they're appreciative of it. It seems to go away for a little bit and then it pops back up. So we're trying to be diligent about that.
I'm sorry, where is this?
Let me.
Morningside Estates on the west side of I-25 by the fire department where the helicopter used to be. Right in that area.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
I think any point, and I appreciate that, the update, I know it mentioned, and you mentioned today, that the 72-hour warning, it feels like a very passionate frustration, and I can understand that, but anytime you get a resident who's now, you know, kind of sending photos and taking video of an instance, that makes me nervous for that person who is trying to prove to us that this is in fact happening. And I feel like that person could be in danger as well by doing that. So I would love to just hear us try to expedite resolution. I know this is a bigger issue than just removing some vehicles, but I'm concerned for the safety of the folks who are trying to prove to us that this is in fact an issue.
Yeah, and I know our code enforcement did speak with that citizen today, I believe. I don't know, it could have been yesterday too, but to notify us directly instead of going the indirect route of an email, because that might take a while to get to us.
Right.
So, and getting to us quicker and calling us directly to handle a situation.
At the time.
The time.
Yeah.
So that's been addressed. We'll keep working on it and take a little bit more of a proactive approach on a continuous basis instead of reactive when citizens call on it. So,
great. Yeah. Thank you. Appreciate it. I suspect that during budget season, we'll talk more about that with neighborhood services. Great. I'm going to slide it in anytime I can.
We got great ideas regarding it as well.
Great. Look forward to it. Thank you. It is the Fred way. Any other trustee reports? Hearing and any reports from staff?
Now, the only other thing I have, Madam Mayor and Board, is that we will be sending out probably in the next week just the information regarding the snow removal / plowing program. It's really just broken down to a menu of options. We've got levels of service, A through E, options, how much it would cost to get where we're currently at, what it would look like to get to these different levels. So we want to have that ahead of time for you So you can think about it. And then as we have the meeting, it should be a briefer discussion. So look for that in your mailbox in the next week.
Like briefer.
might be grammatically correct. We don't know. I have one other item before I propose a motion to go into executive session, but thank you for that. And I don't know how to say this without it sounding like a mom or something, but I'm concerned, you know, in instances like we just had tonight, and I'll learn from this as a mayor on when to take a recess, but I can feel energy, I can feel anxiety, and I'm always going to ask for a recess when I can feel anxiety, when people are unsure. So please let me know if that's off and you don't want me to take a recess. But asking for a recess then gave an opportunity for an applicant to kind of corner our staff and have conversations that I don't appreciate. So I'd like to talk about maybe what a protocol is if there's a recess, if it's the board goes into another room or vacates, and as does the staff. I'm just concerned that that opened up an opportunity for our planning team to have to deal with a relationship that they didn't incite, I did. So I'm concerned that maybe we need a proper protocol in place to protect professionalism at best. Can we talk about that?
Yes.
Is that a very mom thing to bring up? I'm sorry, but
With our facility challenges, it's a really unique setup here. But in most organizations, and we can work to position the room, but typically when a recess occurs, the governing body goes into a different room. We never typically would let or allow a resident to come close to the dais, one for safety reasons, and I think we can do some things to address that. And then certainly allowing, you know, when that happens, we can have staff or the team members to go into the back area too, because there should not be that interaction during that time, unless there's legitimate questions. But absolutely, I think that's a very legitimate request, and I know other cities that I've been part of have done that very well and have been very intentional about that for safety concerns as well.
The only thing I would add is just to make sure that, you know, because it's a public meeting, we respect that public process. So during the recess, if the board chooses to go that direction, use their facilities, et cetera, just, you know, not talking about the issues on the sidebar without the opportunity for the public to have knowledge of what's going on. So, you know, I think that's a fair statement. Fair concerns, and as long as we're making sure we do our part to withhold that public or hold that public trust, that we're not utilizing the recess to have an informal executive session, which is improper.
Sure, I respect that.
And Mayor, I would say too, you and I had a discussion, I would say a few weeks ago, about potentially adding another staff table here. I'm actually waiting just for some equipment to make sure we have microphones, and so that'll kind of a start. And so as we start to move things around the room, like, please provide us feedback. We like this, we don't like this, this feels not open or not, you know, let us know and we can move things around and try things out and see how they fit.
Right. Thank you. Yeah. I appreciate that. I certainly appreciate the formality that we have here. It seems like everyone has mutual respect for one another, but it's always those one-off instances like tonight where you're not prepared and you just, I wasn't comfortable with it. So
we get like a plexiglass wall
and a curtain. Yeah.
We're going to break. Opens up, there's a guy with blue hair. What the heck's going on?
Okay, thank you for hearing my concerns and helping me address those as you can. Appreciate it. Any other trustee reports? All right, I would ask that we now entertain a motion to go into executive session for the purpose of determining positions relative to matters that may be subject to negotiations, developing strategy for negotiations, and or instructing negotiators under CRS Section 246-4024-E1 regarding Miners Park.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and a second.
Trustee Padilla?
Yes.
Trustee Mahan?
Yes.
Trustee Lamont?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem March?
Yes.
Trustee Brown?
Yes.
Yes.
Motion passes 6-0.
Thank you. Let's take another 5-minute recess, please, and join each other in just a moment.